list.
Should we start?
Any issue? Is it? Which one? Which is better?
So this is Rama Nagarajan, is that right? And she is Times of India reporter. I know it, because she's also been a volunteer at the library that I work at. And she has really got a super great insight into all kinds of interesting stuff. So if you have a good question, she's probably got an interesting answer. And about things like public initiatives and that could include a lot of stuff around healthcare, but it could include stuff around other sort of things that the public sector can. Okay, so enjoy yourself. I'm going to come back in a little while.
Do you guys have any sketches? This population is called a demographic dividend, which basically means that you have an advantage that you have such a young population, and that that should give the country an advantage. But that depends entirely on whether that population of young people are healthy, one, educated, they have skills, so that they are employable. So one of the fundamentals that means is healthcare. So if you don't have proper healthcare, if you don't have a healthy population, this demographic advantage that you're talking about, this advantage of having such a young population, could actually become a liability, because you would have a large population of people, young people, in what we call the reproductive age. That is, these people are going to go ahead and have children too. So a bunch of young people who are unhealthy, uneducated, unskilled, that means more than an advantage, it's going to become a liability for the country, which is why healthcare becomes so crucial. Not just for India, but I would say in any part of the world, but especially here, considering the scale of the problem of not having adequate healthcare. So let's look at some of the indices for the country. For example, one of the things that we look at is life expectancy. After so many years of independence, 1947, we became independent. Now we are in 2018. And our life expectancy is 68 years. Now, that's a huge progress from where we started off, which is around 35. that's been progress, yes. But, you know, that you can become really complacent if you look at it like that. Instead, we should also be looking at other countries which are at your level, or which started off around at your level of development, and where are they today? So, for example, China, a little unfair comparison because their development is way, way ahead and much faster than most parts of the world. But theirs is 76 years, 76.7, so that makes it almost 77 years. So you have India at 68 and you have China at 57. And if you thought that's an unfair comparison, let's look at Sri Lanka. Now, so Sri Lanka, the life expectancy is 75 years. So what does that say? You don't really have to be this massive engine of growth and have high GDP to see better health care and better health indices. So Sri Lanka has 75 years as its life expectancy. And if you come closer to our neighbor Bangladesh, their life expectancy is 72. And Bangladesh doesn't even have the kind of economic growth that India is boasting about. So that brings us to the fundamental question, does economic growth necessarily mean better health care? Well, evidence from across the world seems to suggest that that's not necessarily true. While it's great that you have economic growth and it gives you a lot more money to do a lot more things, but the most important thing is when you make a lot more money as a country, where do you choose to spend that money? Do you decide that you want to spend more on defense by buying more weapons so that you're ready for war? Do you decide that you want to spend it on, you know, infrastructure, which is good because we need them, but or do you decide to spend it on things like health and education, which is what will give you dividends in the future? It's not the kind of stuff that you will see immediately. Like, it's not like a road that is being built and you can see it in front of you. Education and health is something that you put into your people. You invest in the people of the country. Again, abysmally, depressingly, depressing sort of statistics is 34 children for every 1,000 children born die in India. Now that's incredibly high. Again, let's go to the neighboring countries like Sri Lanka. That is 7.5 children for every 1,000 children born. So for all these reasons, we are nowhere, I mean, India is nowhere near satisfactory levels of, you know, healthcare provision for the people of this country. And having said that, like I said, if you look at it, progress has been made. It's not all bad. I mean, there are lots of good stories. Like, for example, with a lot of struggle, they've managed to get polio out of the country. So now you don't want to see children becoming maimed because of polio. That's a good thing, but we caught up very late, but we caught up. But when we look at things like TB, I believe some of you are working on TB, so as your project. So 25% of all the cases in the world are in India. 60% of all the cases of TB in the world are in just 6 countries. India happens to be one of them. So you're talking about, and TB is spread how? It's spread through the air. So you can be rich, you can be poor, but you know, TB is all around you. And that is really alarming. But what makes TB most, people may be more susceptible to TB is TB's living conditions. So if you're living in crowded conditions, obviously you're at a greater risk. So where do you find the most crowded sort of living conditions? Slums, which means poor people. So they are most vulnerable. Again, when we come to things like, so living conditions play a huge part. So it's not just about medicines, it's not just about the big hospitals that you see all around. It's not about having, you know, technically perfect PET scans and all the Da Vinci robot knife to do surgery with and all of those things. Those are good, but what you need for public health care is basic things like good living condition. I'll give you a very good example of that. My trip to Germany sometime back, I was taking a tour of the medical museum there. And one of the things that stopped me dead in the tracks was Hamburg, where this museum was. The last cholera outbreak that Hamburg saw was in 1892. 1892. That's some 125 years back. And even today in India, you have cholera. There you have countries which have wiped out their disease, and here we have people still dying from that disease. And not small numbers, 20,000 deaths, 700,000 cases of cholera, still. So what did Hamburg do to get rid of cholera? 1892 is not a time when you had antibiotics. Modern medicine was not even available, most of what we have today. But still they managed to get rid of it. They saw their last case in 1892. Why? All that they had to do was improve their water system. Provide clean drinking water to the people. And that ensured that nobody had cholera ever. So when we talk about people not having access to medicine, you have to think even more, you have to go even more basic here. People don't have access to food. People don't have access to water. Large sections of the population don't have access to water. So those fundamentals, at least in civilized societies, we believe should be provided by the state. That's the reason why you pay taxes. That's the reason why you have a government. So that they use those resources to give you basics like clean drinking water, enough food. Nobody should be sleeping hungry. Unfortunately, in this country, 46% of children are malnourished. Now, if you have 46% children malnourished, that's almost half your child population. So when they grow up, what more can you expect but a sickly population? So that's not going to be the engine of growth that the country is expecting. So while hospitals are good, and especially these days in the news, you have a lot of news about hospitals and how they cheat patients. Because they are for-profit, and for-profit hospitals want to maximize profit by overcharging on all kinds of procedures, making you undergo procedures which are not necessary. And this is not this is wonderfully common all over the world. So wherever you have a for-profit healthcare system, what you find is that there's a lot of unnecessary treatment. So all countries are struggling with it. I mean, US is struggling with it because it has a highly privatized system. So they are struggling with how to tackle rising healthcare costs, because the costs keep rising as people want to make more and more and more profit. India is facing the same problem because almost 75% of your healthcare in India is provided by private sector. The government sector keeps on shrinking. So why does the government sector shrink? Because the state doesn't put in enough money. So you're getting richer as a country, your GDP is growing, your economic growth is very high, but none of that money is coming into the sectors like health. So that's a problem. So so if you reach a hospital as a poor person, if I don't die of malnourishment, if I still have survived bad water, and then I fall ill and I reach a hospital, chances are, if it's going to be a private hospital, and if it's a private hospital, knowing that, you know, I can't really figure out what's happening, they might tell me that, which has happened to a lot of people. If you Google hysterectomies, you will find that lots and lots of women who went to the hospital were told that you have a problem with your uterus, it needs to be removed. And why? Because they wanted to make a profit of just 30,000 rupees, which the government was paying. So there are all these problems in healthcare, and they need to be tackled. It's so huge, and the problems are massive. But there are always good stories. Like, for example, there are states like Tamil Nadu. So India, when you look at the overall picture, it might look a little depressing, but then when you zoom in into certain parts of the country, they are doing tremendous good work. Like Tamil Nadu, for example, they are doing extremely good work. The government is spending a lot of money on healthcare. Their indices are way better than what it is in the country. In the neighboring state of Kerala, it's the same thing. So southern part of the country is doing better. Northern part of the country is abysmal. And it's worrying because the north is where all the population is. You have Uttar Pradesh, which is your neighboring state of Delhi, 200 million population. Probably if it was a country, it would be, I think, a fourth in terms of size. So it's the size of Brazil. And it's just one state in the country, and that happens to be the least developed state. So it should be worrying. So these are the kind of things that we keep reporting on, hoping to put some pressure on the government, hoping to build public opinion, to demand better health care. I think I should stop there and get you guys to ask questions.
What do you believe the government could do to improve the living conditions of those living in slums, and is there anything the government has done that they could build on?
So one of the things is, in most countries, I don't know about US, but places like UK, Germany, they actually built houses, council housing as they used to call it, for like the local corporation, the civic agency would build houses, and so that the poor could move, they demolished entire slum areas and built houses so that they could live in better conditions. It actually seems like an expensive process, but if you look at it, it's actually going to pay you back, because people living in healthy environment fall ill less, so they become more productive. So they're going to become better tax-paying citizens. So you actually gain from that. Now, if you don't have the resources, there are ways and ways in which the government could do it, because if you open any newspaper, you open any TV channel, you drive down any highway, you will find lots of advertisements saying apartment this, apartment that, on sale. So obviously a lot of houses are being built in this country, except that those houses are not being built for people who desperately need it, right? So maybe there could be an incentive system by which these big companies which are building these houses could be given an incentive, tax incentive, I mean giving them land, whatever it is that the government wants to build an incentive system, to build more houses for the poor. And believe me, most poor people are not expecting freebies. They don't expect you to give them a free house. Even in the slum that they stay in, they do pay a lot of money. There are slum landlords. So there are people who rule the slum, who collect money from the people who live there. So people are paying for living there. They are not living for free. So if the government were to do this, and put in a plan. This has been done in some of the cities, it has worked, and we need to have a lot more of those. People will be willing to pay money to move into a better house. And there's, and you know, cities like just exploding with people because of migration from the surrounding areas. And there's a reason why that happens, because in a lot of cases, the surrounding areas are witnessing complete joblessness. Like, I might have a piece of land and I have three kids, that land is going to be divided into three. So that's not going to be as productive now. So somebody from there has to ship out and go find a job. So this is just natural. These are things that the government should be thinking of when they're planning. So I think, yeah, it's possible.
Thank you.
What is the India's economy spending most on, like, if it's military, if it's education, if it's,
Well, I guess we do spend a lot on defense. We wish they would spend a little less on that. We spend a lot on what we call infrastructure, which is so important. It's not to say that we don't need our roads and we don't need highways that are being built, bridges, and things like that. There has to be a balance. I was really impressed by something I read long ago, that when in World War II, when Germany was bombed, it was flattened, it was absolutely flattened. Today, if you go there, everything has been rebuilt to look exactly like it was before it was bombed. How did they do that? Because before the bombing happened, they had spent a lot of money on good education and health. So the people, you can bomb the infrastructure, but you can't take what you put into the people out of their heads. So there were the engineers, there were the people who were educated, who could actually help to rebuild the country. There's a reason why you say the best investment you can make is invest in your people. You need to invest in their health and education. So while infrastructure is important, you also need to look at some sort of a balance. You can't only be looking at one side. That's all that, I mean, those of us who argue so strongly for more spending on health and education are merely saying a little more balance. And what are we asking for? Our spending is stuck at 1.4% of the GDP. That's among the lowest in the world. I mean, we are equivalent to sub-Saharan countries. And that those are countries which are not seeing the kind of economic growth that India is seeing. So it's not too much to say that, you know, at least spend 3% of your GDP. We are not asking for, like, 50% of your GDP. Well, they're saying 3% of GDP. But even that's not coming, so yeah, it's a natural concern. Yeah?
What do you think about what happened in the state of Bihar? The kids getting ill, as a result they eat the midday meal program, and it's happened very often.
Okay. Midday meal program is a very important support system for people who don't have enough food in their homes. It was started because it was found that a lot of kids are coming to school on an empty stomach, so without a breakfast. So if you come to school on an empty stomach, the chances are you're not going to be able to concentrate on anything that's going on in your class. So first you need to put food in kids' stomach before you can think of teaching them. So that was the principle behind starting midday meal. It was a great initiative, but the problem with a lot of things which are done is implementation. So implementation, you need to ensure that it's done in a clean environment, you need to make sure that, you know, the quality of the food is good. So what happens in most government schemes is they will give us a certain amount of money and they'll say that this needs to be done with this amount of money. So all that money is eaten up in maybe buying the things which you need to cook the food with, or in paying the person who's coming to cook the food, but there is no kitchen. So there is nothing covered. So obviously, I mean, you might have, you know, lizards falling into your food, you might have the food going bad. So all these things keep happening because you don't use kind of sub-fund, you don't fund fully for what is required. You give 100 rupees where 200 is required. That only leads to a bad name for the program, and then there is no sort of accountability. If somebody runs away with that 100 rupees, you rarely find them being, you know, chased and sent to jail for it. One of the things that we keep talking about is that in the sign of a developed country is also when you take your laws seriously, because those laws, breaking those laws have consequences. In India, often if you break the law, the justice system is so overburdened that you don't see cases coming to an end very soon. So people think that I can do it and get away with it, and they do. But if you know that you will be punished, you know you'll be caught. I guess, yeah, that's some incentive to stay on the straight path. Yeah.
Is the cost of healthcare in the slums of New Delhi too high for some, like, poor people, for the parents to pay for their kids who are young and at a younger age?
Cost of healthcare?
Yeah.
Yes, it is high because you must look at it in terms of how much do people earn in a day in slums. So everything is relative. To somebody who is middle class, who has a permanent job, maybe it doesn't seem very expensive, but if you're in a slum and you're a daily wager, and what you earn per day is about, the minimum wages in Delhi I think is about 400 rupees. So that's 400 rupees for four people in a family. That's 100 rupees per head. So what all will you spend on? You need to think about food, you need to think about paying the rent, you need to think about school expenses. So health, what you need to spend on health is a small percentage of that. But unlike other things, like say, if school becomes too expensive, I decide that I'll pull my child out of school. If food is too expensive, I decide to starve for a day. Now those are all decisions which I can take. The unfortunate thing about healthcare is, if I'm sick, I don't have a choice. I'm so sick that I just have to get treated. So the choice is not with me. I can't decide that, you know, I can say, put it off by a day, 2 days, but if I'm really sick and dying, I need to get help.
Are like the, is it like the price is different for kids and adults, or this all the same?
It would be all the same. Depends on who falls ill more often. For example, I mean, if the kid falls ill more often, then they'll have to go to the doctor more often.
Yeah.
And since you don't have a public health system, like in a lot of countries where you can go into the hospital, get treated, and you don't have to pay for it, if you go to a private sector doctor, you do have to pay for every single consultation. So if you can't afford it, either the kid dies or you know, the family goes bankrupt. Because in India, again, they estimate that about 39 million people every year become poor because of healthcare expense. Because somebody falls ill, you break your leg, you go to the hospital, you have to pay so much money for the treatment that the entire family falls below poverty line because they sell everything they have to get that healthcare. 39 million, that's like the population of entire countries. That's like a whole country of people becoming poor because they have to pay from their own pockets for healthcare.
So you mentioned that there were a lot of areas for which healthcare was bad. If the government had to focus on improving one, what would it be? Like, for example, would it be providing better basic healthcare, or providing better education, or providing better water? Like, which would be the most important to at least start off?
See, I don't think you can really say that, you know, I'm going to leave everything else and just do this one thing. It doesn't work like that. It's like saying that, you know, it's like a family saying that I'll only spend on one particular thing and not on anything else. I mean, look at it like a family budget. In a family, when you have a certain amount of money, you spend it on various things. So you, though some things might be more important, that doesn't mean that the most important thing is food, but doesn't mean I spend everything on food. I also need to spend on sending you to school, sending the kids to school. So you prioritize and you spend on everything a little bit, right? It's the same thing with the government. I have a budget, and my budget is limited. So I have to decide how much I spend on what, but I have to make a balance of what I spend where. And sometimes, like in a family, one person falls ill. So resources are pulled from everything else. Like, you use, you cancel that holiday that you were planning to go for because it's too expensive, and instead you spend that money on treating that person. In the same way, the government, when you see that somewhere there's a crisis, then you divert resources. You should be doing that if you see that. So in that sense, if you're saying that should there be a priority in some sector, I would say the most important thing in, for any country should be that nobody should go hungry. Everybody should have basic food and water. Everything else can be built after that, because those are the basics. Because without food and water, even your health is going to be affected. The reason why, we, like I said, cholera, so many people have cholera because you don't have clean drinking water. So if you had clean drinking water, you wouldn't have cholera, you wouldn't have diabetes. a lot of other diseases like jaundice. So many things are spread through these things, through unclean water.
So, with the infrastructure for urban infrastructure, what has happened in China and in India? So in India, the government spends about $17 per capita for urban infrastructure, whilst in China they spend $116 per capita. Do you believe that this disparity in urban infrastructure investment has any sort of effects on the global health and just living conditions of the people in urban cities?
It's $17?
Yes, per capita in India.
Per capita, okay. Yeah, but look at the size of China's economy. So you have to take that into consideration, that what's the size of the economy and what is being spent. So, for example, Sri Lanka, I was just complaining about the fact that India spends only 1.4% of its GDP on health. Sri Lanka spends only 2% of its GDP on health and still manages to have better health indices. So it's not always about how much you spend. It's important. I'm not saying that, you know, without money things can happen. Mm. You do need money. But it's also about how you spend it, how efficiently you spend the money. It's not only about the amount of money that you... I mean, you can't throw money at a problem and say that it will solve it. So, and also you need to, like I said, China, the economy is much, much, much bigger. There is no comparison. So obviously they would be spending... It's like saying, you know, in US, they spend, I think, what, $8,000 per capita on health per head. So it's enormous. So because healthcare is so expensive in the US, and still they have poorer indices than countries like UK or countries, you know, Scandinavian countries. So actually, when you look at it, they're spending a lot more money and they're getting less out of it. So that's really inefficient spending. So that's something that the US needs to look at closely. Why am I spending so much money and getting so little for it? So it is not about how much money you spend. Money is important, but you also need to look at how well is it being spent and how can I improve the efficiency of the money.
With China though, they have, I think, slightly larger urban population than India at this time, mm-hmm. but at the same time, if they do spend almost 8 times more money on it, then, and they have definitely become much more developed than India in the last time.
Absolutely. It's two different systems of governance. So we should take that into account. You should ask yourself whether any of you would want to live in a system like that. I would be very happy for a slightly slower progress, but a little more personal freedom. So I'll give you a classic example. When it came to population, China imposed one-child policy on its population, right? So the one-child policy meant that many people were punished if they had more than one children. They were forced to go in for abortion, right? And by doing that, they managed to curb their population. So what happened when you curb your population? You have fewer and fewer young people, and you have a very fast aging population. And everybody has one child, so what happens is, the children are also what they call the little emperors. People who are spoiled, rotten. So there are all kinds of consequences to these kind of, you know, policies from above which you force down people's throat. And then, at the same time, India, which had no such policy, has faced much more population growth. But today, India is at 2.2 children per family. Now, 2.1 is the replacement rate. So 2.2 is not bad, without any of the coercive policy. So I'm happy for a slower development. If I don't have, you know, the state coming and telling me to get an abortion and wanting to kill off my children because I have more than what they think I need. So I'm not so sure that that's the model of development I would look for, but I definitely want a more efficient system within this system. Yes.
So. Why do you think there is a difference in the education between the South States and the North States?
Difficult question. So I come from the South, reasons, and I've worked for now 20, 25 years in the North. I think one of the reasons is that South has seen a lot more social movements for equality. So if I go from, take the example of my state, Kerala, the caste system was almost demolished much, much, much earlier. But even today in the North, you have the caste system. I guess all of you know about the caste system,
yeah,
right?
Yes.
Yeah, so Kerala also had redistribution of land. So people who had too much land, the government forcibly seized too much land and distributed it to a lot of people. So from a feudal system of upper caste people who held all the land and everybody else being landless and dependent on the upper caste, many of these kind of measures were taken in the South, where caste, there was an active movement against the caste system, so that you try to educate the people, you try to make them feel more equal, and also redistribution of land, these kind of things. North, unfortunately, hasn't seen that those movements. It's still very feudal. If you, even today, if you go to Bihar or UP, you would find that you still have people who are not allowed to enter certain people's houses, untouchability is still practiced in some parts of the state. So if you have that kind of social inequity, development is going to be really, really slow, because development cannot happen in that kind of situation.
Have the recent like political problems in Tamil Nadu, have they affected the amount of health care that the progress of the government, the Tamil Nadu government?
The political problem now, you're talking about instability?
Yeah, like the last year or so.
Yeah. So one of the good things about Tamil Nadu is that it sees a lot of political changes. Like almost every election, there's a new party. The next, you vote out the earlier party and you vote the other party. And then the next election, you vote out this one and then they get the other one back. So this sort of thing has happened in Tamil Nadu very often. The good thing is that, one, they have a very stable bureaucracy, which is all the government systems that actually implement your government programs. Two is, even when the government changes, some of the programs are so popular with the people and you do want to get elected, so you don't change the programs. If anything, you improve upon the programs and try to capture it and make it mine. Like for example, the midday meal. Midday meal which is given to students. So it was so popular with the people that no chief minister, no matter which party he belonged to, dared to stop that program. They would not stop it. They would actually say, okay, I'm going to add an egg to the meal. And the next guy would say, I'm going to add a glass of milk to the meal. So that, you know, I am more popular and more popular and more popular with the people. So that has actually helped the state. In the North, unfortunately, and in many states, what you see is the next government which comes tries to dismantle what has been made to leave their stamp on the administration, which is unfortunate because the sufferers are the people when that happens. I feel that's why, you know, Tamil Nadu, in spite of such political instability, still does pretty well on social indicators.
So you mentioned that Germany has done really well cholera in watering and water culture, but do you know anything that the government has done about here in India?
We only talk medicine, unfortunately. That's most of my frustration when I'm writing about healthcare here, that we only talk about medical solutions to the problem. We rarely talk about preventive. So we're talking about curative healthcare. So we talk about, you know, better, more doctors, more hospitals, this and the other. Whereas, like we have seen in the case of Germany or in many, many other countries across the world, clean drinking water is what is needed. So while the government does have a program, there is a huge central program which funds water and sanitation. But as with a lot of other things, the funding is very poor. There's a lot of leakage, which is a nice way of saying there's a lot of corruption. So, you know, leaking of funds at various stages. But primarily, there is not enough funds. I mean, there is not enough priority. The government decides that this is important, they would put their weight behind it. But then, you know, it's more talk and little of implementation. So those preventive things, to prevent these things from happening, would be more sensible than to talk about curing after you have got it. It's like the obesity epidemic that everybody, all over the world, countries are dealing with. You have diabetes, you have heart diseases. All of these are extremely expensive to treat. And they affect people in the working age population, like diabetes, for example. And you can prevent them. You can prevent them by, you know, focusing on the food that people are eating, focusing on nutrition and activity, levels of activity and all those things. But no, I mean, most countries are not so interested in focusing on the prevention aspect. The money is all dumped in the curing aspect when somebody has already got heart disease, already got diabetes, when it's so much more expensive and so much more morbidity or, you know, suffering for the person.
How do you, what do you think about the people that the rural migrants who come from the countryside of an India, say that Delhi and Dubai, how do you think they deal with inexpensive amount of healthcare? How to deal with that?
Actually, when you come from the rural area, you actually think you're better off. And often you are. For example, in rural areas, I might walk 10 kilometers to get a pot of water, which I have to carry on my head to bring it back to my village. One of the things that most of the migrants, urban migrants, will tell you is that what thrills them the most is open the dam and there's water. And that's like a miracle for them, because that's something that they haven't had in their villages, and they still don't have in their villages. In the same way, often villages have no healthcare whatsoever for kilometers around. You might have a primary health center which is run by the government, no doctor, the doctors are absent, there are no medicines, all of those problems. And even if a private sector guy wants to, they don't, private sector doesn't like to go to those places because there isn't enough money to be paid. People are too poor and more scattered in that sense. So actually when they come to the city, they feel that they have better access in terms of, there are more clinics and hospitals and doctors available. But then the point is, can you afford them? So most often what happens is, if you go to a lot of slums, they have a lot of quacks practicing. People who are actually not doctors, but who just pretending to be doctors, because they know a little bit of medicine. They worked in some hospital some time ago. They saw some medicines being written. So, you know, they set up a clinic and people are very happy, because many people think that, you know, I have an ache and I go to the doctor, and even if he's a quack, if he gives me a painkiller, I think, wow, suddenly the pain has disappeared. I'm feeling better. This guy is really good as a doctor. But, I mean, he might be overdosing you, and some other illness that you go to him with, he might give you the wrong medicine, which will get you into a lot more trouble. So all of these things are problems. But on the face of it, for a lot of urban migrants, they feel they're better off once they migrate. And, you know, I mean, why only the poor from rural areas? I am a migrant too in the city. I have migrated from state which is far down south to Delhi, because my state doesn't generate enough employment. So I'm looking for better opportunities when I come to a place like Delhi. So in many ways, I'm not different from the migrants who come from rural areas. I'm also coming here looking for a job. It's just that I have more resources. That makes all the difference.
So how would you effectively educate the families on the importance of healthcare? The people keep saying that if you give an education to the children, they understand. But there's only so much that children can do, like with their families, because in the other families, like, they believe that other stuff is more important, which it is, but they still don't spend enough money on healthcare. So how would you educate the families?
Actually, almost all the studies that have been conducted show that if the parents are better educated, the children have better health. So education does make a difference, especially if the mother is educated. So women being educated makes all the difference. So this is not one place, it's across the country, in little cities to the most rural of places, it holds true. If the woman is educated, the child has a better chance of survival, will get better health care. So while you might not be able to teach everything, I think education makes a huge difference in how people access and react to health emergencies, how they take those decisions of, do I need to take my child to a doctor right now, or can I just sit on it? So those kind of decisions, I think, education does help you make those informed decisions. It doesn't, I'm not saying that it's the answer to all the problems, but it does make a difference. And like I said, it's borne out by lots and lots of research. And it's not just in cities, it's everywhere. And every stage of education makes a difference. The more educated you are, the better the outcomes for your children, actually.
India is it's a democracy. So do any politicians ever run on clean water and improved healthcare? explain the contrast?
If you look at election issues, health is never an election issue. And I don't know why, but health is never an election issue. Water is an election issue. So you can win if you promise water supply, even if you don't deliver it, but the promise matters. So water is an election issue. Often electricity is an election issue. I mean, assuring them that you will supply power to the village is an election issue. For whatever reason, corruption is an election issue. It's very popular. I mean, if you say that I will wipe out corruption, you will get elected. But health is not. One good thing that can be said for this government, which is in power at the center right now, is that they, for whatever reason, have been talking a lot about health. It's been a lot of talk, this much talk and this much action, but the good thing that has come out of it is, for the first time in the history of this country, health is actually an election issue, a campaign issue. When the Prime Minister, for example, was campaigning in Uttar Pradesh, neighboring Uttar Pradesh, for the election, he was actually talking about, I reduce the price of cardiac stents. That's so esoteric. I mean, the guy in the village, what does he know what stents mean, and does he even understand what this guy is talking about? But yeah, but he thought this is important enough to talk. And the fact that this guy is talking up health so much makes a difference. So for finally, right now we just had the budget for the whole country being passed. Usually after budget, you have all kinds of discussion about, industry and growth and blah, blah, blah. This time, for the first time, the biggest issue talked about after the budget was a national health protection scheme launched by the central government. So that's a change, and I'm very happy for the change, because I'm seeing it for the first time that, you know, these are the big health-related issues are being talked about. But even as I'm being happy, I know that the national health protection scheme, which was announced, has no funding to back it, so it's not going to get off the ground. It's all talk, but at least it's the beginning. I mean, if you start talking about it, maybe it will become important enough for people to demand that. So maybe in the next election, they will expect more out of their leaders in terms of healthcare. So that's the hope at least. Fundamental problem to many of these deaths is malnutrition. So you have really underweight babies being born to malnourished mothers. So if you don't have good food for the mothers, you have babies who are underweight, so they have less chances of survival, because all of us know that if you don't have enough food, your immunity is low, your ability to fight off infection is very poor. And also, if over generations, if you're starving, you start shrinking. That's called stunting, which is why you will find a lot of poor people are much shorter. They're shorter because over generations they've had less nutrition, so they start becoming shorter and shorter, which is called stunting. For a long time, India argued that as a race, as a people, we are short. It's not because of malnutrition, because we didn't want to accept that, you know, it's malnutrition which is causing it. But then a whole lot of Indians who went to other countries in the West, they, after two generations, became really tall and big. So then they said, okay, the myth is busted. There's nothing like that. If you get good nutrition, you will not be stunted. So the race argument has been demolished. So what happens when you, coming back to the kids dying thing, so what happens when you have stunted mothers is that stunted mothers have narrower hips. So during delivery time, there are much more complications. So if there are complications, the chances of your child dying are much higher. And again, many of the mothers have anemia. Anemia is, again, you know, lack of hemoglobin in your blood. So what happens is then the chances of hemorrhage, that all kinds of complications that can happen, is much, much more. So all of these are fundamentally related to, like I said, the most basic thing, which is people should have enough to eat. And not just enough, but nutritious food to eat. So if you don't have that, that becomes a problem. Second layer, you have the problem of, you know, I don't have enough doctors, I don't have enough gynecologists at the village level. But that's at the second level. At the most basic fundamental level is you are not getting enough to eat. People are not getting enough to eat. Yeah.
With healthcare not being a central issue to run by, I believe that that could do with the fact that healthcare is a thing that most people don't really think about at the moment. It's something that you always think that will come sometime later. You never expect it to be at the time. So with water and with food or available electricity, it's always at the time you always seem to need it.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Yeah, actually, that is the reason, because none of us think that we will fall ill. So I mean, everybody thinks that they are perfectly fine till the day something actually happens. So that's not the uppermost issue in your mind. So I guess that would be the reason why water and food, because it's an everyday thing. Said there is more hospitals and doctors available in urban areas, but having said that, I don't think that's entirely true that the urban healthcare indices are way better than rural, because urban is also includes the urban poor, and that's like the majority of the population in a city. So what happens is their indices are often worse than the rural areas, especially in India, because often the urban poor, unlike in rural areas where you have a support structure, you have a family, you have some amount of land to sell when there is an emergency. So there is your relatives who will contribute money to help you out and things like that. When you move to a far away city, what happens is you leave behind all these support structures and you don't have the kind of support like some land to sell, nothing. You just have that rented space in which you're living. So if there's a catastrophe like a major disease in the family or somebody had an accident on the road, the chances are that you will just fall through completely. The entire family goes down because you will be rendered homeless and out on the street. So often, especially among the urban poor, I'm not saying always, but in many places, the health indices, like, you know, what percentage of children have got their vaccinations, is sometimes poorer in the urban areas than in the rural areas. Simply because many of them don't have access in terms of money, and many of them are daily wagers, they're working so hard to, like, you know, make ends meet, they don't have the time. So all of those reasons often contribute to urban poor being worse off sometimes than people in rural areas. Not everywhere, not always, but like I said, yeah. But yeah, you can see in any place, you can see the difference in terms of availability. There are we have more doctors than we need in urban areas. Much more than WHO says that you need a certain number of doctors for every 1,000 people. We have double that number in urban areas. And we have a complete shortage in rural areas. So that's one of the reasons.
What do you think is the biggest issue or problem in the youth program? What do you think is the biggest issue in the Midday Meal program?
I think the stinginess of the government is the biggest problem. Because they spend something like, I think about 3 rupees on the food. 3 rupees? In this day and age, I'm amazed, you know, at these guys. You know, that's the amount of money you're willing to spend on the meal of a child. What stops you from spending 5, 7, 10, if you know that it's effective, it's good for your kids? But, you know, they are so stingy about everything. They're not willing to spend money on these things. That's very frustrating because you're buying really poor quality food and you don't have any of the necessary infrastructure required for that. How can you spend 3 rupees on a meal and expect that the child will be well fed? I mean, it's beyond, like, you know. So you need people to go out there and tell your newborn, the new mothers, that this is what you need to do, right? So there's a lack of awareness. Now, how will the awareness happen? The awareness happens through having enough health workers. Thailand, Vietnam, all these places have completely changed. Rwanda, again, completely changed the way healthcare is delivered by just hiring thousands and thousands of trained health workers. That again means you need to pay money. You can't expect them to come for free. That's something that again the government is not willing to spend on. Every study across the world has shown that the most effective way to provide good healthcare is to have health workers and volunteers go out and actually talk one-to-one. Because human beings, there's nothing more effective than a one-to-one communication. You can have television programs, and they talk about all sort of high-tech things like, you know, we will send messages on your mobile phone about health, how to look after your health. I'm sorry, it doesn't work like that. I mean, it might work for one or two people, but what's most effective is if you have somebody sitting across you and telling you how to do things. So if we had more people who could go out and advise mothers, like we have managed to push up institutional delivery, that is, you know, delivery in a proper health facility, to 80% plus. Now, if that's the case, why isn't our immunization 80%? Why is the immunization still around 72%? That's because your health workers have to follow up the mother who just gave birth and ensure that she brings the baby and gets the vaccination done. There is no health worker to do that. In India, health workers are paid something like, I think, 1,500 a month. 1,500 a month is, divide that by 30, it's like, you know, 50 bucks or something like that. So, hugely underpaid, and you're expecting them to do good work. And you call them volunteers, so that you don't have to give them any benefits of employment. So the government calls all health workers volunteers, and they pay them really poor remuneration, as they call it, because they won't even call it salary. They're so scared, if I call it salary, I might have to give them some rights. So they call it remuneration, they hire all these, and all of them are women. So the entire health system is running on the backs of women who are underpaid, overworked, and with no rights given to any worker. So if with that you are expecting that things can change, if whatever is happening is a miracle. Because of all these, you know, women who are actually working better than they should be working.
That is interesting, because there's a similar sort of program with the development of, so to say, communities in certain urban areas where also it's all run by women.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're also called volunteers,
mm-hmm.
which is very
interesting. Because often the women ask the question, will the bureaucrats become volunteers? You know, I mean, and accept remuneration and not salaries. So they frame the policies, but, you know, I mean, none of that is available to the women who actually work at the ground level, the ones who are actually implementing your plans. So in the states where they are given more money and they are treated better, which is the southern states like Tamil Nadu and Kerala, things need to improve a lot more there. I still think it's not enough, but it's a lot better than up here. You do see better results.
What would you mention that happened was
that government subcenters are the last rung of the government health system. So each subcenter is supposed to look after, I think, about 5,000 people. And you have a male health worker and a female health worker who will be there. So they are not called volunteers, they are called workers. But again, they are paid badly. And often many of them are on contract. So what that means is I don't have a permanent employment with the government. So every 6 months or every 11 months or whatever, I need to go and get my contract renewed. And every time I need to get my contract renewed, I need to bribe somebody. So there are all these problems that are there when you don't have a permanent workforce which you can depend upon. Like, there's this disease called guinea worm disease. That has been eradicated from this country. And And that's been done by, it'll be an interesting project to look at how no medicines were required in that. It was completely done through just change of what they call behavior, what you do when you use water sources, strain the water that you use, all of those things. And that disease has been wiped out from this country. Now nobody, you can't find a single case of anybody having that disease. And that was done through a permanent workforce of the government, which worked extremely hard in these remote areas, like in Rajasthan, for example, which is a desert, in those areas, to bring about, to educate these people, make sure that they changed the way they used water, make sure that they strained the water every time. What we have today is, without spending a penny on a single medicine, that disease is wiped out from this country. It's gone. In fact, I think there are only about 4 cases left in the world.
What do you think the main solution the government should follow to like end TB? Like, for example, is it like to feed people, to educate people? Like, what is it?
So what are the causes of TB? One is, of course, that if you're living in close quarters, in crowded places, then if one person has TB, you can infect a lot more people, right? So one thing you need to ensure is that, you know, the living conditions improve, so that everybody is not huddled around. Second thing is, in TB, you need to have treatment available to people who are diagnosed. And the treatment is long and it's painful, because there are a lot of side effects to the kind of TB medicines we have today. Because TB was seen as a disease of the poor, there's hardly any research into TB medicines. No pharmaceutical company is interested in doing TB research, because it's not it was not seen as a disease of the rich man. So we have old drugs which are still being used for TB, and many of them have very high rates of side effect. So long treatment with side effect mean many people actually stop the treatment halfway through, unless you have these volunteers, run after them, catch them, counsel them, and bring them for treatment, and give them the support that is necessary so that they complete the treatment. Now, what if you don't complete the treatment? Then what you have is, if you leave your treatment halfway through, you have not taken the full course of the drugs, so the TB bacillus is going to get resistant, because you have not knocked the guy out completely. You have not killed the guy, you have basically knocked the guy out. The guy will wake up after some time and gets used to the idea of this medicine, so you're totally resistant to that. And we see a lot of that in India. And the more number of drugs you become resistant to, the more expensive your treatment becomes, because all the cheaper drugs can't be used anymore, and you have to move more and more and more and more expensive drugs. So what the government should be doing is have effective treatment so that people will complete their treatment. Two is, you need to go out and find where these people are, and so diagnosis and screening them and finding out who are the people is important. But again, we come back to the same old thing. You can drop all the drugs you want into a TB patient. The only way the drugs will work is if I have good nutrition. So if I don't have food in my stomach, the drugs cannot work, and TB will come back. So then when it comes back, often it's going to come back as a drug resistant. So then you have a problem plus X. And then when one more drug, and then again you have no food, and that drug also you become resistant to, then it becomes TB plus 2X. And it just keeps, and now we have multi-drug resistant TB, which is becoming a threat to all the not just India, but it's all over the world. People are worried that we'll reach a stage where there will be no drug which is effective against TB, which means we see a lot more people dying, not just in India, but anywhere in the world, because these TB bacillus is carried through the air. So if somebody with multi-drug resistant TB travels to the US in a plane, they're going to be carrying that around and spreading it all around. And it's not just here, it's with, you've seen SARS, you've seen the swine flu, which came from the US and then spread. So all these diseases now, earlier people used to believe that, you know, it's happening in the poor countries, they can die, I don't care. But now it's not the case anymore. World is so connected that nothing stays in one place. So what's happening today, tomorrow, I mean, like the Zika virus from Brazil, which traveled all over the world, like the swine flu, or the one which, the bird flu, which traveled from China to many other parts of the world. So we live in such a hyper-connected world that nobody is safe if somebody is not, I mean, if everybody is not safe in that sense. we should be more bothered about these pockets of poor healthcare.
Any more questions? No? All right. Please give her a round of applause, please. All right, so...